We do not have a quorum today. Alderman Rainey is out honoring the life of our fire chief chaplain today at his funeral and memorial services. And Alderman Braithwaite has had a family matter, and he may be here in time. So the first item on our agenda is actually approval of the minutes from our February 7th meeting that we cannot take action on. I do have the minutes for review, and we will take action on that at our next meeting. So today we have our first discussion on remedy. As we work through this reparation process, housing and building wealth through housing and wealth loss through housing has been a priority and a concern. And with that, we have focused on that as our first initiative or our first remedy to pursue. We have had the support of the Dearborn Realtors as well as NARAB on a national level in helping us think about housing and how we can use our reparation fund to expand housing or homeownership in the Black community and how that will build wealth. So what we have today is a presentation. The presentation is prepared by Mark Austin, and it is supplemented by Shorefront Legacy and Dino Robinson with actually archived data and reports and maybe news articles that speak to the narrative that is explained in this report. So we're really grateful again to Dino Robinson at Shorefront for everything that you're doing to support us through this process and lead us through this process. And Mark comes with a very high level of expertise in housing policy. So I am going to read his bio while he'll be joining us remotely from Los Angeles. Mark Austin is the owner of Austin Associates Mortgage Company. He is the immediate past president, vice president of the California Association of Real Estate Brokers. Mark has served as the president of the Consolidated Board of Realtors of Los Angeles, chairman of the Public Affairs and Mortgage Banking Committee for the National Association of Real Estate Brokers. Mark has been in the real estate profession since 1989. Mark is a highly regarded public speaker and public policy strategist in the area of housing finance opportunity. Some of Mark's most recent past achievements and current involvements include, and this is a short list, I'm going to go through it though. Successfully led a national initiative to include real estate brokers in distressed property disposition, which brought millions of dollars to inner city communities. Spoke in the United States Congress regarding the plight of urban housing. Recently testified in Congress before the Subcommittee on Housing and Finance. Presented to Congress a public policy white paper identifying the impact and result of underserved financial services in inner city communities. These things are relevant to the community that he serves. Los Angeles County Board of Supervisors, outstanding achievement in his community, and a list of outstanding achievements in Los Angeles, Inglewood, National Association of Realtors, Broker Professional of the Year. He's been Realtors of the Year. He's been Realtor of the Year. Board member, Consolidated Board of Realtors Los Angeles, board member, Los Angeles Museum of African American Art, past board member, Many House Women's Recovery Center, and past board member of the Seattle NAACP. So as I'm working through this process, remember this is innovative work. There has not been a municipality to look to as a reference or with a best practice. So we have searched the nation, as well as our community, for policy experts and other experts that can really weigh in on what might be remedied, what might get us the repair that we're so deserving of here in Evanston and that we're committed to. So Mark, thank you very much for your commitment and your support and your leadership as we work on reparations here in Evanston, Illinois. Thank you for joining us. So you're in a room, we're in a committee. There are dozens of invested residents and stakeholders that are here to weigh in, and we're gonna be leading this together. So thank you for joining us.
Thank you. It's my pleasure. I'm actually honored to have the opportunity to speak to you, to speak with all of you this morning, as well as I am so proud of your leadership with regard to a municipality that's actually making positive steps to make a difference. These type of steps aren't easy. They're met with opposition both inside and outside. And so I'm just really proud to be able to contribute, however small it is. I want to share with you something that we call the state of housing in Black America. It's relevant to Evanston. And it helps to have an idea of what's really going on. Sometimes we know something's wrong, but having the data and the historical content accurately portrayed allows us some freedom in moving forward. So, state of housing in Black America, I'm a member of the National Association of Real Estate Brokers. I have to say that. We're an organization that was founded in 1947 to promote democracy and housing for Black people. We weren't allowed to be members of the National Association of Realtors at that time. So we formed our own organization. We're 73, 74 years strong. We have chapters in 33 states, including Chicago, where Courtney Jones is the immediate past president. And I was just there. So the state of housing in Black America, hopefully you can see my screen. I'll run through it. 44%. This is the national home ownership number for Black Americans. 44%. That's fourth quarter. Just came out January 30th, 2020. Slightly up, but we're always up as a result of the end of the year. What it has been. 73.7% is the homeownership percentage for white Americans. And I have to say, this is the state of housing in Black America. So I'm going to talk from a Black perspective, and I hope it's okay if I'm just Black today. I don't want to hate anybody, I don't hate anybody, but I'm going to be Black in terms of my perspective and description. So 73.7%. is the homeownership percentage for white America. 29.7% is the gap between white and Black home ownership. This gap today is larger than it was in 1968. Prior to 1968, discrimination and racism were practiced, traditional, and legal in America, and yet that gap is 29.7%. That gap represents the wealth difference, the wealth inequality between Black and white Americans. In the United States, the home ownership percentage by race, white is 73.7, Asian 57.6, Hispanic 48.1. You can see that Black Americans bring up the rear at 44%. Why is that important? This is aggregated across all ethnicities. You can see that in 2010, the top line being the net wealth of homeowners and the bottom line being the average net wealth of all renters, regardless of race, $5,400. In 2013, it went up for net wealth of homeowners, $195,400 from $187,000. The net wealth of renters basically stayed the same, but with rising rent in a rising economy, the net wealth of homeowners went up to 225 and the net wealth of renters went down. If this were specifically Black, if the net wealth of homeowners would be 90% and the net wealth of renters would be 2,000 and below, in some cases and in some areas, negative net wealth. My contention and the contention that I think is acknowledged throughout most of home advocates is that this is intentional. This was not accidental. This just wasn't the result of happenstance. That public policy and tradition have served the Black process and severely restrict Black home ownership opportunity. How do you say that happened? And I understand that there's some conversation as to whether it's a federal issue as opposed to a local issue.
but I need say that it began with localities, municipalities. It began with racially exclusive zoning. It began with real estate agents steering black borrowers into one area and being supported by law enforcement and steering white borrowers into another area. It began with public policy and racially exclusive zoning. In Evanston, you passed a law in zoning ordinance in 1919, which put most of the areas that blacks had started to migrate out of away from West Evanston and made them commercial and forced them back into West Evanston. Racially exclusive zoning was outlawed by the Supreme Court based on a lawsuit in Louisville, Kentucky. A black man bought a piece of land in a white area with the intent to build a house and live in it, and he was sued by the neighborhood because there was a zoning ordinance that said blacks could only buy or live where the blocks were black, and whites could only buy or live where the blocks were white. And he was sued. It was upheld in Louisville. It was upheld in Kentucky and overturned in the Supreme Court. So another method came into play, which is also prevalent in Evanston, of private covenants. When I sell you my land and you intend to build a house, we put into the contract that you cannot sell it to blacks or other ethnic minorities. Happens a lot, and the covenant runs with the land. This was made unenforceable by Supreme Court decision in 1947. Now, we've all heard of government redlining. Federal government institutionalized racism in housing when it authorized the Federal Home Loan Bank as part of the New Deal to put in place government maps that would separate that they would use for underwriting purposes for who was going to get a mortgage and who was not. Those maps, this is the Evanston, some of you are probably familiar with it, redlining map. The green areas are the new build suburbs. The blue areas are the traditional all-white neighborhoods, green being all-white, blue being all-white, yellow being commercial and mixed, red being black neighborhoods or undesirable neighborhoods. This is Chicago, which is reminiscent of and a replica of Evanston and every other city, that they mapped around the country, Evanston being this one, Chicago. And this is how they graded them, green being first grade, all white new subdivisions, blue being second grade, all white older subdivisions, yellow mixed race neighborhoods and industrial, and red predominantly black neighborhoods. This is a comparison of two appraisal forms at the time. The blue, you see the security grade was second, that was a blue area, all white traditional, and the third was, the second one in yellow is a third grade, where industrial mixed neighborhood. If you look down, it says Negroes, yes or no, in the blue it's no, in the yellow it's yes. Down a little farther, it's 0% in the blue and 1% Negro in the yellow. What that did for mortgage availability was ample and limited. HUD, which was financing houses that these maps were used for, in the blue would make an 80% loan to value loan. So the borrower could come in, put 20% down, and buy a house. In the third grade area, it was a 15% loan to value loan. So because of the presence of 1% Negroes, you had to bring 85% of the value of the house in to be able to buy. In red, there was no mortgage availability from any institutionalized sources at all. As a result, in Chicago, and it's famous for this, private contracts, because blacks wanted to buy and want to own, just like everywhere else, we started buying from the people who had migrated out of those areas with private contracts. We used private contracts to buy 75%, 75 to 95% of the 60,100 homes that were purchased by black families from 1948 to 1970 were financed by private seller contracts. The problem with that was that they overpriced it. The average price markup was 84%, $12,000 houses sold for $22,000. An estimated $3.2 to $4 billion worth of loss just in Chicago. And the problem was that the deed didn't change hands. The title never transferred until the contract was paid off. So if anything happened, you lost your job or had a momentary lapse in your ability to sustain that payment, then you were evicted like you were a tenant and it was resold again. This was a devastating loss and has been the result of lawsuits in Chicago. It said a good head start beats a fast run. What I'm saying by that, when you've had is had government local and municipal policy and traditional policy to restrict black housing and black housing opportunity, fair housing and equal housing will never catch you up. When you've had a 236-year head start, it legalized racism. If I don't do something that not just levels the playing field, but tilts the playing field to our advantage, then we'll always have status quo that are important to understand. This is 2019 income numbers, Asians being the highest paid entity at $91,414, whites at $70,727, Hispanics at $51,747, and blacks at $43,966, the lowest paid ethnicity aggregated across the country. This is household income, not per capita. It said that blacks have 5.5 cents for every dollar white people have. We are now in a robust economy. It's 10%. It's for every dollar white people have, blacks have a dollar. Why does that matter? The average FICO score for whites is 734, for blacks 677. When you have less wealth and you make less money, while you want to pay on time, any emergency, a plumbing emergency, a car breakdown, changes your ability to make some payments on time and affects the overall FICO score, credit score. Access to credit is based on scoring. Mortgages are now based on scoring. Starting in 2008, Fannie and Freddie instituted risk-based pricing that price people based on how much they put down and what their FICO scores were. If you put less down and you had a lower FICO score, even though you were approvable, you pay higher costs. Prior to 2008, that was not the case. That is still the case today. We call it loan level price adjustment. They're in both the pricing for the traditional standard loan and they're in the private mortgage insurance if you put less than 20% down. I call it the four pay more fee adjustment. An idea, this is the Fannie Mae matrix that shows what you pay based on your down payment and based on your FICO score. I sent a copy of this presentation for your later review. You can take a look at it. You'll be able to show that if your average FICO score, right after FICO score 734, and they put 5% down, there's a 0.5% adjustment to the cost. If your FICO score is 677, which is the average black FICO score, and you put 5% down, there is a 2.25% adjustment to the cost. That cost is made up in interest rate changes. You buy a $300,000 house, this is a comparison between the average white buyer and the average black buyer with the same, both of them approved, different FICO scores, same down payment. 15% down, $285,000 loan amount. The 734 FICO score is going to get a 3.375 interest rate based on those adjustments, while the 677 is going to be a percent higher to cover that additional cost at 4.375. It equals a payment for the white borrower, $1,259 a month, for the black borrower, $1,422 a month. That's $162.99 a difference monthly. May not seem like a lot pays the bill, but over the life of the loan, $58,676. That's a significant difference in the ability to either build or not build well. Appraisals are a problem in our neighborhood. Evaluation code of conduct, which was put into place in 2008, got rid of all of our traditional neighborhood appraisers and made us have to deal with appraisal management companies. The problem with that is they reduced the price the appraisers were being paid, so most of our traditional appraisers that were familiar with our neighborhoods quit. And now we have people from outside the neighborhood who don't feel there's any value in the neighborhood coming into our neighborhood and doing the appraisals, coming in low in an environment where prices are rising. This kills a lot of deals for us to have to renegotiate our contracts and lose our value. Some statistics, there's some statistics to back up and undergird what we were saying. Population of the United States, 327 million approximately, 60% white, 13% black. Hispanics at 18, Asians at 5.9%. Total mortgages last year in the United States, 7,720,000. White, 5 million mortgages. Blacks, 430,000 mortgages. Nationally, the black denial rate is 31.14%, almost twice that of the white denial rate, 17.87%. Only 45.71% of black mortgage applicants were approved. The problem with the approval rate being so low is that it affects the collective consciousness of the community. When over half the people that apply for a mortgage are turned down, that gets into the mainstream of conversation, and our young people, while they want to be progressive, they want to look successful, they want to be successful, having such a low approval rate causes them to go buy some other type of asset as opposed to taking a chance on the emotional distress of not being approved, and they go buy a car or something else that depreciates as opposed to an appreciating asset. In Illinois, close to the home, total population 12,741,000, whites are 61% of the population, blacks 14.6%. Of the population, it kind of mirrors, close to mirrors, the United States population. Total mortgages in Illinois, 260,472. Whites, 173,401. Black, Hispanics, 27,980. Blacks, 15,401 mortgages, 18, almost 14,000. Blacks are 14.6% of the population, but only receive 6% of the new mortgage. The black denial rate is 30.13%. White is, that's incorrect. White is 16.47%, almost twice that. The black approval rate mirrors close to what the national approval rate is at 46.689%. Closer to home, Cook County. Population 5,180,493. Cook County's population has a higher diversity. It's whites 42%, Hispanics 25%, blacks 23.9%, Asians 7.9%. Total mortgages in Cook County, 98,231, whites 52,000, blacks in all of Cook County got 9,943 new mortgages. I think I should say that these new mortgages don't just represent new purchases. They also represent refinancing. People pulling cash out or lowering, getting the new low interest rates that improve their disposable income or their financial situation. The denial rate for black applicants, Cook County is 31.96%, for whites, half of that. The approval rate in Cook County is lower, 43.74%. My experience is that the higher the black population, the lower the black approval rate in that particular locality. Blacks are 23.9% of the population, but got 10% of the mortgages. In Evanston, at home, total population, approximately 74,756. 59% white, 16.6% black, 11% Hispanic, and 9%, 9.3% Asian. Total mortgages, new mortgages of all in Evanston, 1,487. Whites received 1,023. Total new mortgages in Evanston for blacks were 95.
Wow.
Asians 11 and Hispanics 8. Blacks are 16.6% of the population, but got 6.3% of the new mortgages. The black denial rate in Evanston is 33.18%, more than twice that of white. At 15.39%, black approval rate is 42.6% as compared to the white approval rate of 67.57%. This kind of encapsulates, doesn't change no matter what city I go to. Chicago is the same way. Total mortgages for blacks in all of Chicago, 5,200 of the 45,922 mortgages. In Chicago, 13,190 black families applied for a new mortgage, and only 5,200 were approved. That speaks to the systemic discriminatory practices embedded in our housing finance services today. It just moved from zoning and private covenants and redlining to financial services and the way that loans are underwritten today.
What do these statistics tell us? What they tell us is that we have to be advocates for risk.
I'm not a Dodd-Frank proponent. I think Dodd-Frank has built a barrier instead of a bridge. I think that we've been told that we don't want, they want to protect us from losing. We want to have sustainable home ownership, and we do. But the problem is you're protecting us. You're setting the bar so high, we can't get to it. I think it's more racist to protect me from having a chance to allowing me to have a chance and fail on my own with my own trying. So we have to be advocates for risk. We have to be advocates for programs that will take a chance on us based on an optimistic future as opposed to a pessimistic future. And then I think this applies to Evanston and what I see you doing. We have to develop positive and assertive programs and initiatives. I think what you're doing, home ownership is the primary indicator of the well-being and wealth of a community. I think what you're doing to provide some asset or some asset capability in Evanston is very important. We can't take public policy for granted. This is where the differences get made. They get made in your council meetings, they get made with your alder people, they get made with our state and federal representatives, they get made in the form of public policy. We can't take it for granted. We can't stay at home and not vote. We can't not go to meetings. We have to participate if we're going to move forward. Maintenance of status quo is the overwhelming social construct. How it has been is how it will always be. If we don't buck the trend, then we'll be doing the same thing, looking at it the same way. We can't be quiet and move forward. And I agree with Martin Luther King. Our days, our lives begin to end the day we become silent about things that matter. We have to speak up. I want to applaud for leading the nation and what I think is a progressive, assertive, innovative idea that I'm hoping that you have success with and that it becomes a blueprint for the nation. Thank you for allowing me that time.
In your written report, you spoke about remedy in the way of housing, down payment assistance, closing cost assistance. Can you expand that discussion just a little bit?
Absolutely, and thank you for asking. The number one inhibitor to home ownership is down payment. You know, some of us have credit issues, some of us have too many bills, but most of us working, most of us that are progressive are part of the society, we're paying high rent. We can't save, but we're paying high rent. So down payment assistance and or be it from organizations or from municipalities, bridges a gap for home ownership that we have a lot of credit worthy people that just can't get the down payment and our closing costs together. So I would suggest that you do a $10,000 to $15,000 grant, however you spec it out, to would-be homeowners, to would-be home buyers. And not necessarily first time, but home buyers entering the market for owner occupant housing. That if you had 95 new mortgages in Evanston and you have the potential of $500,000 a year to fund various programs, if you did a $10,000 to $15,000 grant, FHA is 3.5% down, Fannie has a 3% down program, that would boost the opportunity for people to be able to buy houses. I think that's the most bang for your buck and low hanging fruit. I like to win. So I look at where do I get a win at first. Creditworthy borrowers, FHA will loan down to a 580 FICO score with 3.5% down. Fannie and Freddie, the floor is 620 FICO score. We meet those criteria. People think you have to have 20% down and a 700 FICO score. That's just not true. That's just not true. So down payment assistance in the form of a grant, I think, doesn't have to be a big money grant, but I think that would be towards providing what I like to think is reparations for tilting the table in such a way that we get an advantage.
Thank you, Mark. And because I want this to be a working group, a actionable experience, I'm going to take three questions from the community. Is there anyone that would like to ask Mark a question? Kamm Howard?
Yes, Mark, in your report, you talked about depository institutions and non-depository institutions and why utilizing one is, as opposed to the other, is more beneficial.
It's my experience. It's not just my experience. The data, Home Mortgage Disclosure Act is data that requires all lending institutions with regard to mortgages to report their results. That's where we get the numbers from. Every depository institution is worse than non-depository institutions. What do I mean by that? Wells Fargo is worse than Quicken Loans when it comes to black folks. The numbers are why they're disparate. Wells Fargo's approval, and I don't mean to call people out, but a spade is a spade. Wells Fargo's approval percentage for black borrowers is 31%, down from 42% last year. Quicken's approval percentage is 69% for black borrowers. So if I got a choice as to where I'm going to apply for a loan, and I'm not advertising Quicken, I would say find your local loan mortgage professional. But if I'm going to see where I'm going to have success, it's going to be with the people that are more apt to approve me. I don't know why that is. Banks have other sources of business and income. Mortgage lenders only do mortgages. So it's a big difference in approvability and focus between a depository lender, and I put you some of your depository lender numbers in that report. I just didn't know who your big lenders were, non-depository in your area, and I didn't have time to contrast it. But I would find who's working in your area, who wants your business, and I would partner with them as a place to refer our people to.
Mark, I know you mentioned the credit affecting the outcome of approval rate. But I also would like to know what would be the impact of assisting folks in raising their credit. And I'm not talking about the traditional debt consolidation kind of things and stuff like that, because I believe credit still is a legacy for family.
Hey, Lonnie.
Hey.
And his daughter, Tasha. Even in the form of airship and properties, having families keep their homes traditionally and having them better prepared to receive the land or the housing that was once lost. Because one of the blemishes in our community here is parents leaving their houses to their children and their children aren't prepared to receive it, and so on and so forth for various reasons. Sometimes it's taxation, sometimes it's not having the income to be better to fit it. So as a complete package, what would you suggest is helping them keep it in that aspect, including the credit?
So thank you for your question and comment. In Los Angeles, blacks are sellers, not buyers. That's a problem we have. The prices are high and we can't afford it. So our neighborhoods are changing rapidly. My neighborhood used to be all black. Now it's almost all white. And we just can't afford the price. In terms of credit, there's some misunderstanding with regard to credit overall. I think we need to understand that credit scoring a score is required because we have computer underwriting. Lenders run really affects your score. The type of credit has a heavy factor on score. Watch out for these new Prosper and Lending Club and those types of personal loans will pull your score down as opposed to giving you additional score. We've got to learn how to, and I'm guilty too, I have four children, and preparing our kids for what's going to happen. Reverse mortgages have a place, but generally our kids aren't ready to pay that loan off. They get a house that's free and clear, the first thing they do is borrow on it, and they didn't pay for the house, so they don't pay the mortgage and they lose the house. It's real important that we start to pay attention to. I don't want to mischaracterize it because we want to pay our credit. I found out it's a whole lot easier to pay my bills when I have a whole lot of money than when I don't have much money. And the reality is, a lot of times our capacity is just so low. We have to make financial decisions. So we got to watch out for consumerism. Got to watch out for the TV. Got to watch out for now. We have to change our mindset. We aren't in that place yet.
But thank you for speaking to us today. And I would like you to possibly make a suggestion to Alderwoman Ruth Simmons about approaching banks to lending us money. At one time, we went to Bank of America. My family owns over $10 million of property. And we had no mortgage, didn't owe taxes or anything. And they said, no, they will not give us a loan. So we need to know, and maybe that you could advise her how to approach banks that will lend us money. And we have good credit and we pay our bills on time. And we were astonished and closed our account with them. Because that was very ridiculous. And I know that white people that don't even have as much property or income or anything as we did can get loans, and they don't even have file bankruptcy or any, we don't even have any of that. And we need to know, or maybe you can guide her to talk to some of the financial institutions and who will loan us money.
Thank you for your concern and question. Let me say that there obviously is disparities in lending. What you have to do is plan for it. Banks generally follow guidelines. They generally don't keep the loan. Nobody has portfolio products anymore. They either sell it to Fannie Mae or Freddie Mac, or they sell it to FHA or Ginnie Mae. And as a result, they underwrite to that. So one of the suggestions that I have in the report is pre-purchase and financial counseling centers. we've got to start going in and preparing to borrow. We gotta know the guide. You gotta talk to somebody who knows the guidelines so that you can make your situation fit the guideline so they can't say no. My experience is that this is not a mysterious process. If my borrower fits the guideline, they have to give me an approval. So you may have great credit and you may have a great property with no mortgages, but if you can't show the ability to repay, if your credit, if you're self-employed or you have write-offs or you have income property that you take your proper and should take deductions, but then it lowers your income so that your debt ratios are out of line. In other words, your mortgage payment is $2,000 and show your income at $1,800, then they can't loan you because they have to show by law the ability to repay. Seems unfair. That's what happens. There are other types of products for that situation, but of course that involves risk, so then it's a higher interest rate, a lower amount that you can borrow, and a little higher cost, but you save money in the taxes. We have to plan to do this. Not saying that you weren't treated unfairly, just not being, and if I were in the room and could see everybody, I might could talk a little freer.
yes, you're correct.
So you know what I mean?
Yes.
So we gotta start talking to our professionals. We need more black professionals in this space. And then we gotta stop. You know, when I was raised, it told me mind your own business and stay out of others. We got to start recognizing. We got to share our business. We got to get that people in. We got to start so that they can guide us where we need to be.
Perfect. Thank you. So we have two final comments, but I want to say this so that I don't miss it. To Mark's point, financial literacy and preparedness is absolutely important, especially as we're working on this reparation fund. What I don't want to happen is we get an approval to give out, as recommended, $10,000 or $15,000 down payment grants, and we can't credit qualify for the mortgage. And so with that, I have jumped ahead of the reparation program with the approval of a financial literacy agreement with First Northern Credit Union. So some time ago, I pushed through economic development, and it's now approved that we have an exclusive agreement with First Northern Credit Union. They're downtown Evanston on Sherman. And you can get financial education, financial literacy, credit building tools at no cost from that credit union. So they are working on implementing more of a financial fitness campaign, so we could do it collectively as a community. But right now, they are our service provider for financial education. So thank you to First Northern Credit Union. Additionally, tomorrow, and I mentioned it at our last meeting, Turn Up, so excited about this, we're having the Community Day of Wealth. It's presented by Mark's colleagues, local Realtors Group, Dearborn Realtors, and Ebenezer AME Church. It'll be here in the Civic Center. It's going to be a day of wealth building, including financial education, mortgage approvals, learning how to be an investor. If you're already fortunate enough to own your home and you'd like to build wealth through investing in property, multifamilies, that's a way that you can, one, participate in providing housing, possibly even affordable housing, while building wealth for your family with that rent paying down your debt and building equity. And so it's a wealth building tool that we want to educate you on. It's one that I use personally to strengthen my family. So I'm going to encourage you all to come there or send someone that you know that needs to build wealth, buy a home, to that event, as well as if you're interested in entering into the real estate industry as a career path. So it's a full day. Children are welcome. There'll be some events for kids. It's going to be catered locally. We're going to have a DJ. It's going to be a good time. Leon Rogers from GCI will be there. He's a realtor, as well as many banks that are participating. So another thing that was really helpful in Mark's report is he shared a report that said, like, what our local banks were doing as it relates to mortgages. So in all fairness to the local banks, I want to shout out those that are sponsoring this event that will be there. So we have, again, First Northern Credit Union that will be there. We have Bank of America, BMO, and then outside of our community, we have Federal Savings Bank, Associated Bank, Legacy Home Loans, as well as Freddie Mac will be there presenting. And we have our local favorite, Cobalt Banker will be there. And Ms. Vanessa McCoy will be there as a local broker to educate us on how we can build wealth through homeownership. So, and I can speak to everything that he spoke about, the barriers of entering the mortgage market, the intimidation of the disapproval. And I was one that went to Quicken Loans because I was too ashamed to go to a bank and be turned down. And I thought, wow, this is, it's online. No one has to tell me no to my face and that sort of thing. So we need to push on the banks. We'll be doing that together. I'm going to continue to be coached by Mark on how I can be a better advocate in the Evanston community and how we can get more loans. So we have two final comments in the back. Yes.
Uh-huh. Thanks for speaking to us today. My concern is, in the 80s, I was working at a company and I was trying to buy. I had someone that was counseling me, and two institutions did turn me down. I was a single parent, and I think during that time I was at $8,000 yearly, and I was told at that time that I would have to be at $15,000 or $16,000, I think, yearly. So for a single person today, because there are two people are working two and three jobs to make these mortgages now, so is there a set income salary that a person has to be at single to buy a home today?
So, thank you for your question. What, there is not a set income. We qualify you based on what's called your debt to income ratio. Just as a general guide, you can figure that the mortgage payment, taxes, insurance, and how much you pay on the bills on your credit report, not your lights and gas, add all of that. Add up together, look at your gross income, not your net, your gross, how much you would have got, and if it's half, you probably can get a house. FHA will finance you with a 50% debt ratio and 3.5% down. So if you make $1,000 a month and your bills along with the new mortgage payment would be $1,500 a month, you'll be approved for your debt ratio. FHA. That's a general, just consumer type. I don't do it that way, but consumer thinking, that's about how you configure it. The problem with us, a lot of times, is we don't want to live where we can afford to buy, so we go on and rent and make it look better, thinking our first house has to be our dream house. Sometimes, in order to get inside our debt ratio, we got to move into a neighborhood or area or a property that doesn't suit our fancy, but fits our pocket. So I can't give you a set number. If you call me, I'll look at your numbers and look at the property you're looking at and tell you what it is. But there's a lot of people there that can do that too, especially that Dearborn Realtors group. I recommend them highly. There's somebody that they can refer you to that can definitely show you what to do.
Perfect. Before we get to our final comment, Lonnie, I do have a question about traditional affordable housing purchase programs that have a condition where the property itself has to stay affordable, like in perpetuity. So the challenge that I see there is that the family has the experience of home ownership, but they don't realize the benefit of home ownership because they're not able to get the full equity paid into the house because the house still has to be sold at an affordable rate. And right now, these are only the only type of affordable housing programs that I am familiar with. Can you speak to that and if you can recommend or direct me to find another model that might work better?
You know, that's a model that reminds me of San Francisco, where the average price, home price, is $1 million for a single family house. So they have affordable houses that are set aside They run 700,000 or 800,000, 600,000, 700,000, 800,000. You got to wait 10 years to be able to buy them, and then be able to afford them when you do buy. When I talk affordable housing programs, what you're speaking to is set asides for properties that have in the deed. They were built a certain way, usually as a result of a contractor building a subdivision or something else. He had to build a certain amount of set aside houses for affordable housing, and in the deed it says this house cannot be resold unless it's sold to a person who's at 80% of the area income or something like that. Affordable housing programs for me are things like Home Ready, or Home Possible, 3% down programs. There's another program called the Genoa Fund that you should get in contact with. I can give you their information. They provide down payment assistance as well. A second trustee that allow you to get in your house with no money down. When we talk affordable housing, one is to build houses that you can afford, but then they usually have those deed restrictions that you're talking about. The other is houses that are in an area where it's affordable by the populace that we want to address. Gentrification, I understand, is a problem in everywhere. What's interesting about gentrification is it takes one person to take a chance first, and other ethnicities will usually take a chance at a bad neighborhood because they know that it has potential, and then they're followed by member people that look like them. We exit neighborhoods that, as opposed to take a chance at bringing the neighborhood back up. There's a lot of affordable housing. I've not been to Evanston, but there's a lot of affordable housing in neighborhoods that we just don't want to live in. Schools ain't right and so on, but we don't bring our good stuff to those neighborhoods, and so we never get the affordable benefit of that housing. I know that's not an exact answer, but that's what I've seen. Programs and programming stuff that make affordable mortgage products turn all moderate type housing into affordable housing. Affordable housing that was constructed that way is usually restricted to a limited population.
Perfect.
Does that make sense? Did I answer your question?
That answers the question. And so tomorrow at the housing event, I'll talk more about really just encouraging us to take advantage of what is naturally occurring affordable housing and does exist in our community, but might need improvement. And there are mortgage products that can help you finance the improvements as well as a mortgage, like 203K FHA. So there's going to be a workshop on that tomorrow, so that we don't shy away from opportunities because of the condition of the home. Lonnie Wilson.
Absolutely.
What I would like to talk about a little bit is about wealth retention. And what reminds me of that is a person that's in my own family who lives down the street from you. This is the east end of the Stokey floodplain. And most of the houses in this Ward area, the damage that they have is about water around the foundation and mold and other things that end up causing health problems and other things. This is the oldest stock of housing in Evanston, Illinois. So when we start talking about affordable housing, when people are looking for affordable housing from other places, this is where they look, because it's cheap to buy. And we've got to find a way to, I know Ms. Payton and other people have talked about this, but we have to find a way to help our older homeowners, African-American homeowners in this town, retain the home that there is right now today.
And we don't
do that all. Future planning is really great for people with money, but people without money need to talk about today.
I was going to say, as a caveat to when you're taking a look and fleshing out how you want to do what you do in terms of the money, perhaps some of that could be the same grant for purchase, could be the same grant for retaining and improving existing homeownership.
Thank you, Mark. That certainly has been a goal, and the feedback from the community that we work on preserving the existing housing stock, especially as generations can inherit that wealth. So thank you very much.
Thank you. And we have next a presentation from Mr. Bennett Johnson. Mr. Bennett Johnson has been trying to educate us for at least 20 years, maybe 50, specifically about a real estate tool that can help us invest the money that we do have, investing it in real estate. So Bennett, I don't want to jumble it up. If you don't mind coming up and sharing with us what you think might be a good use of our reparation funds.
The important concept in this reparation thing is not just getting money and giving it to somebody and they have fun with it, do what they need to do. The important thing is to realize that we have a capitalist system. We're not socialists, although there's been talk about it. But socialism means the government owns everything and everybody else works for the government. But the concept of capitalism means that you work for yourself or you have other people that you exploit and they work for you and you make money. Now, since we have access to substantial capital based on what Alden and Simmons have done, then we have to do something with it other than just give it up because it'd be gone. We have to find a way to make it self-sustaining. And capitalism, as you know, is all about growing wealth. One of the best examples is Bloomberg, who came from being poor to being rich, and Elvin against the other guy who came from rich to being a fool. No names in general. There is a thing called a real estate investment trust. I started one back in 1970, I guess it was. And I tried to get a couple started here in Evanston. We were going to fall out, I don't want to go into detail. The point is that a real estate investment trust is an entity like any kind of investment group that can lend money, that can buy property, and the owners of the trust are anybody that you want. In other words, anyone in this room can buy shares of beneficial interest in the trust, or anybody else in the world can buy shares of interest in the trust. Obviously, if the first thing you think about somebody with a whole lot of money comes in, buys a lot of shares and controls it. That's not the way it works. They have what they call a voting trust. Within the trust, there's like an executive committee that controls all the activities of the trust. And that means that they're voted in for 10, 15 years, however long a period, and then you can insulate yourself and the activities of the trust from some big company coming in buying a million shares and running everything. Now, the point being that if you have a real estate investment trust, it grows like any other corporation based on people buying shares in it, based on any kind of, if you buy a building and it increases in value, the trust increases. So point being that over a period of time, instead of having spent all the money, you've grown a thing that really is substantial and will continue to grow and may become the biggest thing in town. So that's the first concept that we handle the housing problem, or strike that, help handle the housing problem. And he talked about grants. I think it's better to give no interest or low interest loans because you're not trying to make people happy. You're trying to make people functioning in society. And if you give somebody something, they just are happy. But if they have no interest or low interest loan, then they have a responsibility and you help them grow than just make them happy. And that, although we want to make everybody happy, the role of this thing is to make
people smarter.
Smarter and develop power and the independence in this particular city that I've been living in for a long time. I'll take questions. I got other stuff I can talk about. The only thing I wanted to mention that he talked about the real estate, Dearborn Real Estate Board. I went to Roosevelt College with Harold Washington, Congressman Gus Savage, and Dempsey Travis. Dempsey Travis is the one who organized the Black Mortgage Fund back Well, back when we were
a little younger. Right.
So anybody got any questions?
I got one question.
Yes, sir.
The business district's in the Fifth Ward. The Simpson Business District, the Emerson Business District, the Church Street, we have never, as African Americans, owned those properties. We've always either rented, but there are people who need brick and mortar places. Wouldn't a real estate investment trust be a vehicle that we could use to buy these business districts?
Well, the answer is yes. The facts are that Myers owned the building at Emerson and Dodge.
Yeah.
Mr. Myers had a hardware store on the corner.
Okay, that's the thing.
And he lived in the house adjacent immediately to North was there. And he owned that whole property.
Still one.
Yeah. The answer is the way I got involved is I'm somewhat of an expert on minority economic development. And so we were trying to get loans for the grocery store, and the bank would lend money to buy product, but it wouldn't lend money to buy the building and so forth. So the guy wanted to know how to do it. So a young guy from Richmond, California, which is near in the Bay Area, came up with this idea and brought it to me. I mean, we all worked together at that point. And that's how I first got the idea of a real estate investment shop. Because then the grocery guy could buy the building and then not worry about the bank providing money. So that's how I got involved. Yes, ma'am.
Hi. My name is Indona, and my question is for both Ms. Robin Simmons and Mr. Bennett. So I'm a licensed stockbroker, and I've worked in finance and investments for over 15 years. And I had spoken to Mr. Bennett and Mr. Lonnie Wilson a few years ago regarding the real estate investment trust, which is a wonderful idea. But I was also wondering if there were going to be additional conversations regarding other types of investments, like diversifying the investments of the funds that are going to be received, not just a real estate investment fund, but things such as bonds and so on. And if there has already been something planned to be able to have further conversations on how to invest the money once it is received from the tax revenue.
Well, first of all, not only do you have a real estate investment trust, the other thing is to have a small business investment company, a venture capital group that would lend money to start businesses and so forth. And that again, alongside the trust, would help grow businesses. In other words, the trust would buy the building and you as a business person could borrow or start something in the building. So the idea is to have something that grows and well, rather than just administer the cost of spending money. I don't know whether that answers your question or not, though.
So I'll just add to it. We would have to decide on this as a model. And so the first concern that I see is the way that we're going to receive the funds. We're not getting one $10 million check.
Right.
We're getting the proceeds over time. And it might be challenging to get, with the cost of land acquisition in Evanston being a challenge, it might be challenging to work at that model. It's certainly one that I want us to be talking more about, and I'll do my best to research, work with Bennett, work with you if you want to talk more about how we might further invest the proceeds or the revenue from the real estate investment trust. But the way the money is coming in is where I see the challenge being because of the cost of buying property in Evanston. But we're still discussing that, and that's what these meetings are about. So I'll be taking that. Our staff is taking great notes on this, and we'll be digging into it a lot deeper. And thank you for sharing, and please feel free to follow up with any more information.
And some of the wealthy clients you have can buy shares.
Yes.
community-minded people in Evanston who are wealthy, who would probably take the opportunity to invest early. And then also we have the banks, because since they know that the $10 million will show up, they may advance funds through the trust.
Great idea. Thank you, Mr. Johnson.
Yeah, ma'am.
And so I wanted to just note, you've heard me mention N'cobra quite a bit. N'cobra has been one of our supporting organizations that has facilitated many introductions that we've needed to move this work forward. They've helped us with thinking about it, the best practices. N'cobra is the National Coalition for Blacks for Reparations in America. And they were the one that actually requested on our behalf the report from Mark Austin at NARAB. So I just want to thank their national co-chair that is here with us, Kamm Howard. Thank you for supporting us in this process. Thank you. And we now have community engagement update. So this guide will be available online sometime this coming week. We talked about it. It's going to be a facilitator guide for the community to use. And so there's not much for communication or discussion there. And then we have public comment.
Find it out whether I'm at you or the group is interested in concentrating on the senior housing for two reasons. Many of the people I've talked to that are neighbors that are no longer employed, they're retired, and these are 100-year-old houses that need fixing up in Evanston. And they're not working, they can't afford to get loans. And I was thinking maybe through the some grant to some of the elderly that have paid taxes for years here, that we can do something about that. And maybe we can do something about taking the existing homes that they have and expanding it so that the family and the parent could be taken care of with the home that they're living in now, but separate from the younger group. In other words, we need to do something about seniors having to just go to a nursing home that are not being treated well, that their clothes are being stolen and all that kind of thing, and not getting the treatment they need, and the state's paying an arm and a leg to keep them there. And they could be better served if they had type of housing where the existing, they're living with family and they could be cared for, they're better.
So I agree 100% with you. It is a absolute priority and a goal. A couple months back, I went with our staff to DC to work on just that. And so we came up with an idea to use our accessory dwelling expansion as a way to create intergenerational wealth and intergenerational housing, which would allow the seniors to age in place and allow either a accessory dwelling by way of coach house or a livable basement unit or some other sort of multi-family situation where the senior does not have to be displaced. They can age in place. The next generations can also live in that house, and all of the incomes can support the household, and you can keep the house. Much of the problem that's been mentioned is our seniors are losing their houses because of the cost of maintenance. These old drafty houses in Evanston are over-assessed with county property taxes. So we're working on that. And as you know, we talked about in our last meeting, the goal is to have all these recommendations before the City Council for a June 5th introduction. So please keep sharing those comments and know that it's being worked on. And Ms. Keaton Payton?
My favorite subject is affordable housing for tenants. As you know, we don't have the landlord like myself. We've been landlords for over 50 years in Evanston, and always almost half of our units are always affordable units. Right now, the city has gotten behind a lot of developers like the Link, the Albion, and so forth. And those units are not for families. They have studios and one bedrooms, and you're not going to make it with giving all these bonuses and permit, you know, waivers and so forth to developers, including ADUs. And ADUs are a nice thought, but what's been circulating, an ADU is going to cost
$300,000, well, that's like the price of a home.
Right.
And how many people with ADUs are really going to rent to a mother with five children? It's not going to happen. So landlords like myself are disappearing because we're not going to be able to keep up with the rents, which an average rent for a studio apartment is $1,800 here in Evanston. And so you have more luxury apartments and less affordable units. So if there's not any movement made, there won't be any affordable units anywhere.
Good afternoon. Back 20 years ago, I was an investigator for interfaith housing on fair housing here in Evanston. We sued a lot of realtors and we won. Here it is 2020 and nothing has basically changed. My question is, when are we going to hold these developers accountable for the units that the city is accepting fines for instead of renting to people? That would solve a lot of these issues, because when I was a child, I remember when State National Bank, which is Chase Bank, was the first high-rise to come to Evanston. Now look at Evanston. People are moving in, taking advantage of what we worked so hard for, and we cannot even rent a unit that they lied and said was going to be set aside. Hold the city accountable. Make the city stop taking these fines. It's a payoff.
Thank you. I'm very thankful for the presentation. That both presentations, I feel like I learned a lot. And on the first presentation, what stuck out in my mind was he was talking about being agents of risk. And I think that risk taking is part of success. A lot of people have said it, but I think that we need educated risk. So I think I want to piggyback on the importance of not just having education about credit, because he mentioned some things like we need to learn this about credit and how it affects your approvability that I didn't even know, or maybe I know and I forgot, but I did work in banking in my former life, and that's where I learned a lot, and I realized that, you know, with the effects of the oppression and the racism comes the generational poverty. So along with that goes things that we're not knowledgeable about, maybe because we've been forced to learn how to just survive. Mm-hmm. So from my parents, I didn't learn a lot about finance. It's not just credit. It's a bigger issue here with even the language and the understanding about finance. I didn't get that from my parents. I learned, Lord forgive me, how to rob Peter to pay Paul, because that's how we had to survive. And so my parents were intelligent, knowledgeable about things, but when it comes to finance, even in our conversations in the Black community, there is a lot that we're not exactly aware of still. The average, I mean, like he said, he's an expert on economics. There's other people in here that are knowledgeable about economics. So my whole point is that we need, like, along with this grant or these help for the down payment, I've seen other models in the city, which I didn't personally experience, but they had comprehensive education, like a program that a person will enter into, and they do get credit help, but they get other information that will help them to be successful. Because he said, I like to win. Let me tell you, I love to win, but what I hate is to win and then start losing, you know, two steps forward and two steps back. I don't want someone to give me a down payment and then I cannot keep my home. And that's not what I want for my people. I want us to be able to envision more of us as homeowners, because I felt for a long time like, how can I ever even own a home? I'm struggling trying to keep someplace affordable. So I want us to be able to envision that, and I believe with more knowledge comes power, and if we have a comprehensive program that will give us more knowledge about finance, economics, and credit, then we're going to be more empowered to stay winning, and that's what I want. It's my house.